Well, good morning. Great to see you all. Welcome to New Hope Church today. It's an honor to have you with us. If you are a guest, thanks for joining us on the Sunday right before Thanksgiving, the beginning of a vacation week. We're so glad that you were here, and we'd love to know that you were here. And there's a guest card. It says communication card on it. We'd love for you to fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by later. And next week through the mail, we'll let you know what we believe and what our ministries are and what our service times are, and hopefully answer most of your questions. Always comes with a promise that we won't beat on your door or bother you on the phone. So we would love for you to fill that out. Let us know you're here so we can put some good information in your hands. To the rest of you, great to see you back. Thanks for showing up today. It's wonderful to have you with us today. We're looking for rain. Hope it gets here before the day's over. All right, that would be absolutely awesome. Let me highlight a book that you see kind of up here in front of the podium. Shelley showed this to me this past week. She ordered one for the two of us. We're going to be doing this together starting December the 1st. It's called the Doodle Journal Bible Study. Now, I'm not going to do the doodling. I'm not a doodler. Shelly is, all right? So Shelly's going to do the doodling, but we are going to do the study part together. It's for 24 days, day 1, day 2, day 3, all the way to day 24. So guess what day it's going to end on? Christmas Eve. The last one you do is Christmas Eve before Christmas Day. And it's probably not more than about 10 or 15 minutes. And what this does is it ties the promises and the prophecies of the Old Testament to their fulfillment in the birth and life of Jesus Christ in the New Testament. Really is pretty cool. And there's a way for you to journal if you choose to journal. There are some scripture references to look up and some applications that are made. And then there's opportunities to doodle and to color. So after I saw it, I thought, this would also be a great thing for parents to do with their kids or grandparents to do with their grandchildren for the first 24 days of December. And so I really went out on a limb. I had Shelly order 20 of them. I know, we're going to run out in this service because we already sold 8 in the 8 o'clock service, and they're only about 1/5 the size of this group. So here's the way this works. The price on them, I think, was $17, so either I have to charge $15 and make a loss, or I charge $20 and we make a profit. So you figure out what you're going to pay for it, because I'm not. That's too complicated for me. Here's the deal. I'm not making change, all right? So you give me a $20 bill, you pay $20 for it, you give me a 10 and a 5, it's yours, I don't care how it works, and all that money is in my right pocket, okay? So all the money is in my right pocket. So I guess I could do what I did in the last service. Are there folks who know they want it right now? Raise your hand, okay? I'm a first come, first serve, and it's the first, okay, first row. So see, this is what happens when you sit in the back, okay? Hand the money down. Fawn wants it. All right, hand the money down. All right, boy, look at this. I'm a book hawk. Just one. All right, no, another one going down there. All right, I got to go to the other side for a minute. I got to go to the other side. Yep, that's for you. Okay. Okay, I got right here. Okay, all right, this is good. I got one right there. Okay, you know the people in the back are going to be really ticked off at me. So here's the deal. Hold on. Okay, it's going into the right pocket. Right pocket, all right. Here's what's going to happen. I'm going to hang this suit up when I get home. And when I take it out next year to put it on, I'm going to find all this money in this pocket, all right? And trust me, I'll be asked about this money when the service is over. Okay, we got one right here. Okay, all right. We got one right here. Just hand the money down. I got one right here. Hand the money down. I got one right here. Okay, we got two right here. I just got to go as I'm going down, all right? I got a plan, though. I have a plan. I got 20, who's going to give me 30? I got 30, who's going to give me 40? Okay, I'm out. Okay, who's the next right here? Okay, all right, I'm out. Okay, here's what I'm going to do. We got these in 2 days, okay? So next Sunday, it's not December 1st yet, okay? So how many left in the room would like one? Stand up. I count better if you're standing up. Okay, I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, okay? So, let's say 12 for this service, so somebody keep track of this for me, all right, babe? Okay, all right, and then we'll I don't even have one left to show the next service. We have one in the office. Okay, great. So we'll have one, and we'll show up next service. But I think it's going to be really cool. And then, you know, hey, guess what? We run into each other. We got something to talk about, all right? Hey, how'd you doodle today, all right? And we'll go from there. God, that was fun. I forgot how much I enjoyed working at the Bible House. That was really cool. All right. Next Sunday, still November. The following Sunday, we are now in the last month of 2016. It is Christmas month, so let me kind of lay out the schedule of what's going to happen Christmas month around New Hope. All right? On December the 4th, we are going to say Merry Christmas to the Actus family. They are flying in on the 3rd, and they will be with us on the 4th from Africa, from Uganda. So the kids, everybody's going to be here. We'll be highlighting them in the service that morning, and then there is an event planned for that afternoon. It'll go from probably 2 to 4:30. Right before that event at 1:15, we're going to have a church-wide meeting, all right, go over 2017 budget, answer questions, get you approved, and we'll talk about where we are in the county with the building project, all right? So we'll try to answer all those questions as much as we can, all right? And you might ought to pray for your pastor, all right, as we do that, because he shouldn't ever say bad words. And we'll do our best not to. But anyway, and then right after that is over 2 o'clock till 4:30 or so. It's going to be an afternoon celebration with the Actuses. You'll get to find out intimately more about what they're doing in Uganda, and we'll be excited to share that with you. Then the following Sunday on December 11th, because Christmas falls on a Sunday, our schedule is going to be slightly different this year. December 11th is going to be our big Christmas musical. Christmas Sunday, all right? So that's the 11th. It's a week earlier than what we normally do, all right? And one of the reasons for that is because Tim Kepler is with us that day. And he can't be with us the 18th, and he's a centerpiece of our Christmas program this year, all right? So that kind of, it makes logic, doesn't it? So we're going to do that on the 11th. We will have great music on the 18th. It will be the Sunday preceding Christmas Sunday. And Sunday evening of the 18th is our children's Christmas play. All right, so that will be on Sunday evening of the 18th. And then the 25th falls on a Sunday. We are not canceling church for Christmas. Okay? I know there are some who will. I just can't bring myself to doing that. All right? I'm not telling you you have to be here that day. I'm just going to tell you, I cannot imagine showing up for worship on the birth of Jesus, okay? That's just me on that, all right? This would you not show up to his birthday party? All right, so, but we will have a streamlined service that day. There will only be two services. There will not be an 8 o'clock service, all right? We will have a 9, and the staff's hearing about this for the first time. There will be a 9:30 service and a 10:45 service. Okay, so for those who like to do something very early in the morning, you have time to get it done and get here at 9:30 or 10:45. For those of you who kick it off at lunchtime, you got two choices. You'll still, and these will only be 1 hour services. They will be short, you know, shrunk down. All right, there will be our traditional Christmas Eve service at 9 p.m. on Christmas Eve as well. All right, for those who want to come out, we'll fill you in on all those things a little bit later. All right, so those are the update there. So 9:30 and 10:45. Tonight, over in the Bridge Building, potluck. This is for our small groups. We want to talk about the study we've done church-wide together. If you're not in a small group, come join us, find out what we've been doing, and man, we'll draft you into one of our small groups, all right? Would love to have you come and participate with us in the event tonight. It'll be absolutely wonderful. And bring something really good. Because I'm going to be hungry by 5:30 this evening, and so bring something. Peach cobbler is one of my favorites, actually. Just thought I would share that. Staff is going to be a little limited this week during Thanksgiving week. We have some who are going to be on vacation. Some of us are gone for a day, and then we'll be back. So nobody will be here on Thursday, but people will be here every other day. But it'll be limited. There'll be lots. We have two undecorated Christmas trees. I know it looked a little weird. Last week, those trees were there, and they had the angels on it for Angel Tree, and we gave them all away, all right? So that's wonderful, and they're going to get decorated starting this afternoon, Okay? Starting this afternoon through Wednesday, when you show up next Sunday, it'll all be beautifully decorated for Christmas, all right? So, if you have a need at the church office and you want to come by to see somebody, it will be best to call, probably in advance, make sure that somebody's here that you need to see or you need to converse with, all right? Next Sunday night, we'll have an evening service here. It's in your bulletin. It's called the All Church Prayer and Praise Night, and the theme is to adore. We started this last year. Our youth pastor, Chris, and the worship team from our high school department will be leading us, and this is to highlight those four key things: worship fully, spend less, give more, love all. And so it'll be an hour service next Sunday evening, so we hope you'll come and join us for that. Thank you for all of you who have helped in serving and sharing over this past year with all the funerals that we have done around here. We deeply appreciate all of your involvement. Angel Tree gifts, you can turn those in outside under the pavilion if you brought them back today. I'm not going to tell you that. Fawn, you'll also be outside, or you have women who will be outside if you need to get your ticket for the ornament exchange coming up on the first Monday night of December. It's a whopping... the last Monday night of November. Okay. Thank you for clarifying that. I would have been really wrong. All right. Yeah. Anyway, a lot of fun. Whopping price of $1 for that ticket. So they just really want to know that you're coming. Last thing I want to talk about, and then I have a special presentation to make. Dylan Reed is a Clovis Police Department dispatcher. I don't know all the details. Battling cancer. Been battling cancer for quite a while, so it's a big issue. It would be of great help if you are able to give blood. If next Friday, Saturday, or Sunday at Sierra Vista Mall from 10 until 2 o'clock, if you could go and donate and do so under the auspices of New Hope Church, giving for Clovis Police Department Dylan Reed. He's a young man with a young family, and that would be very, very helpful and just another way for us to sort of back the badges in our community. And we are happy to do that. Gil and Angelina are back in Mexico, and next Sunday I'm going to share an incredible thank you note from the two of them, all right, to our church family. It's just an incredible thank you on behalf of the church family for helping them after their house in Mexico burned down. So they are so very, very grateful. If you happen to bump into Rich Smith between services, wish him a happy birthday, all right? It is his birthday today. He is our counseling pastor. Is he, or is he just a year behind me? I know I think he's a year behind. He'll catch up with me for about 3 weeks, and then I will pass him up. All right? Yeah, I've got him by almost a year. So he's a much younger man than I am. I'm going to ask Dawn McGinley if you would come up here, please. Miss Dawn McGinley. Yes, no, you do not tell me no. Get right up here. As I shared with you last Sunday, Dennis, come stand with her, all right? You look better when you stand next to her. we're going to say goodbye to Dawn today because she leaves us this week, all right? And she won't be back except to visit us, and hopefully she'll come back for a visit every now and then. Dennis, we get to put up with him for a few more weeks, all right, until all things get wrapped up, but she been gotten a new position for the university that she works for, and she's going to be moving to Florida. She has family, her mom, her sister, daughter, who all are in the state of Florida, and so she's leaving her church family to go be with her own family. As I thought about this week, I believe Dawn and Dennis were one of the very first families who started coming to New Hope after the merger that wasn't part of either one of the churches. And so she has been here, her and Dennis have been here for almost 24 years, all right? And that's just about as long as I've been here. And it has been a pleasure. Through thick and thin, they have stuck with their pastor. And I am so very, very grateful for that. And many of you know, but all of you might not know, but Dawn has worked with our children's musical and plays for all of those years. 22? 23?
See, we counted 31 total.
Oh, 31. All right, because we did two in a year. That's right. Sometimes we did two a year. 31, all right? And the 3 years here. And she's welching on us for the last one. in just a few weeks. He's got it all under control, assigned the remaining responsibilities out, and so we're grateful for that. So, on behalf of New Hope Church, we have something to reflect your time with us, okay? Your time with us. So we have you this beautiful clock, and it actually is at the right time, and it says, Don McGinley, thank you for your dedication to our children's place for the past 23 years. Time nor distance will separate you from the love of your home church, and you and Dennis will be missed by all. New Hope Community Church 2016. So this is our gift to you. All right, thank you. We're going to miss you. We are going to miss you. Dennis, we will soon miss you, but not yet. And we told the 8 o'clock service we were doing that, and we will tell the 10:45 service that we did it. All right. All right. Now, a few updates on prayer requests. How do you guys like the sign, huh? Check it out when you leave today, all right? That's to be the last thing that you see when you leave the church property. And so, just in case you can't read it, it says, imagine what one seed of faith can do. Start sowing his precious seed. So, as God has sown into your heart his word in service, you go out into the world and you share what God has given to you with others. We have another. One more. This is a prayer request and I guess an announcement. We have a need for some Sunday school teachers. There are some folks who are transitioning out of teaching Sunday school at the end of the year. And so as we head into next year, we have a real need for some Sunday school teachers, 3rd and 4th and 5th and 6th grade. Some of you have heard me repeat this, but I'm going to say it again. From my 1st grade to my 6th grade year, I had two Sunday school teachers. I had two. In those days, they didn't allow you to do a month on and a month off. Jennifer is exceedingly gracious to our Sunday school teachers. Teach for 4 weeks, you got a month off. Teach for 4 weeks, you get a month off. In those days, you taught every Sunday. I had Martha Wiley from 1st through 3rd grade. And she was part of this church until her and her husband moved to Arizona about 12, 13 years ago. I had her from 1st through 3rd grade. The only time I did not have her on a Sunday morning was the 2 weeks that her and Wayne went back to Alabama every year. I had her 50 out of 52 weeks a year, 3 years in a row. I then had Helen Bronstein. Some of you remember Helen. She's now in heaven, all right? She didn't get to go to Arizona first. She went straight to heaven. And I had Helen from the 4th through the 6th grade, and I'm not sure if Helen even missed two Sundays a year, all right? She was that committed to teaching the kids through that church program in those years. What I'm not sure that all of you fully understand is this is not babysitting. This is not child care. This is Sunday school. As you send your kids to public school for an education in reading, writing, and arithmetic, when you bring your children to Sunday school at New Hope Church, you are bringing them for instruction on the subjects of faith and grace and everlasting life. What they learn here, I'm going to go out on a big limb. What they learn here will last them much longer than what they learn in public education. And I am not downplaying public education one bit. But when you bring your children here, they are going to learn about who Jesus Christ is. And those kids deserve to learn it. And so we need some Sunday school teachers. And if we don't have enough come next year, then other staff members will be preaching on Sunday morning while I'm teaching 4th, 5th, and 6th graders. Okay? Because that age group is that critical. It is that critical. The statistics, these are probably 5 or 6 years old since last time I looked them up. But it's something like 62% of the people who are Christians today became Christians between the ages of 9 and 12. That is huge. That is huge. And so it does make a difference. Who makes the best Sunday school teachers? I've had that question asked, all right? I'll give you three groups of folks. Parents, you make great Sunday school teachers because you know kids, Okay? And well, but my kids are in that class. Then you could get to control them. Isn't that wonderful? All right. Number two, okay, don't teach in the age group that your kids are in. All right? Number two, grandparents. You make great Sunday school teachers. All right? Number three, public school teachers. Okay? And I've had public school teachers say, but Tim, I do that all week long. Who better? Okay, who sings on a worship team and who sings in choir? People who can sing. Okay? All right? Guess who can teach kids? People who do it all the time. You are great at it. All right? And you'll be doing this with spiritual rewards instead of just monetary rewards. So those are the three key areas, all right, where you make great Sunday school teachers. But anybody can be taught to teach Sunday. Jennifer has wonderful curriculum. It's easy. It's not difficult. About an hour and a half preparation. You could put more into it if you want to, but it's not difficult. Husbands and wives, you make a great team. All right, boys in the fourth, fifth, and sixth grade, great to have a man in a room. So husbands and wives, awesome. Month on, month off, not very demanding. All right. Now here's the deal. When it's your month on, don't plan an unexpected trip to the coast then. All right, plan on your month off, not on the month on, all right? Be commit. These kids, I wish Bill Eccles was in here. The reason Bill Eccles is an elder today is because of his willingness to teach fifth and sixth graders when he was just a Christian of about a year, 18 months. And Bill said, and you know what? Bill doesn't have any children except for all the kids for the last 9 years, I think, in a row that he's taught in fifth and sixth grade. And then he got them when they got to high school, because then he volunteered to help out in the high school group. And now he's leading the college group, he and Lindsay, in their home. So some of these kids he started teaching Sunday school in fifth and sixth grade hang out at his house four or five nights a week now. Now, that won't happen to all of you. I don't want to scare you away. All right? So are y'all getting my drift? This is pretty important. All right, so I expect Jennifer to have a problem next week, and that is to figure out who's going to be the teachers, because she has so many folks who are volunteering. God bless you, and let's move on to prayer requests. Did I do okay, Jennifer? All right. Jerry Brown, please be praying for him and his health, all right? He is struggling right now. Been to the doctor this week. More appointments in the weeks to come. Ronald Norby, the gentleman Higginbotham family that I shared with you, their father and father-in-law was in ICU and not doing well. He is out of ICU. He's doing well in the San Joaquin rehab, 93 years old. Chris's dad did not have heart surgery this week. There was some miscommunication between doctor and staff, and so some things weren't done that needed to be. That's been postponed for a few weeks. Mike Garrison is in the ICU unit at Fresno Community. Would appreciate your prayers. Fred's daughter, Fred from our church, Fred and Lilia, his daughter, in her late 20s, lives in Dalton, Georgia. Life's a mess right now, and Fred is brokenhearted. So please remember to pray for his daughter, Elizabeth. This coming Friday, we have a memorial service here for Bob. Please remember Debbie as you pray this week. I can't see Debbie. There she is. All right, got to get between the heads there. All right, and her daughter's here. It's great to have her here. Just be praying for them. Michael Kelton, the owner of Inland Star in Fresno, his memorial service will be next Saturday. It was originally scheduled for here. I had some conversations. I didn't think we were going to be quite large enough. And late last night, I got a message. It's being moved to North Point, which I think we'll be able to host that a bit better. And just be praying for the Kelton family. Many of you know his dad, Dick Kelton. He's been around New Hope off and on for years. So those are just a few updates. And then Sue Williams, that's Pat Williams, who's in this service, her daughter-in-law. We mentioned her last week going in for tests. The tests have shown two tumors in her breast, and it's quite possible she'll need four rounds of chemo before they can do surgery. So if you would be praying for Sue Williams. Those are all the updates and things we needed to get to your attention today. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward to wait on us as we worship with our tithes and our offering. Let's pray. Hi, Eric. How are you? Everybody knows Eric Olson, right? Turn around real quick, Eric. I don't do this to all. This is Eric Olson, in case you don't know him. He's also the director of Celebrate Recovery around at New Hope. So if you don't know that, but we're grateful for what he does. He is also an avid Raider fan, and they play on Monday Night Football this week, okay? And they've actually brought me over to the dark side. And that's actually because Derek Carr has brought the Raiders to the light side now, all right? So we are a spiritual leader, so we are so grateful for that. Join us while we pray. Our Father, for the joy of life that you share with us, we are grateful. When this world does its best to beat us down, when we sometimes unknowingly or sometimes, Father, maybe even vindictively, we try to beat each other down, you are always ready to be our strength, our rock, and our encourager. You lift us out of the pit. You set our feet on a solid rock. You put us in a direction that is the way in which you have planned for us. And you bring joy in the midst of pain. You bring comfort in the midst of our losses and our sorrow. You bring to us contentment when everything around us screams at us that we should want more and want better. And so, Father, today we are grateful for the one who cares for us like no one else does. And we trust you with our needs today. For all these requests from health, from cancer, from the needs for comfort and the loss of those who we've loved so very much, we trust you for all those needs. For the hurts that may be unseen to others in this room, Father, they are not unseen to you, and you care. And may we bring our cares and our burdens and our heavy loads in life to you. Lord, for Don and Dennis, as they are preparing to move, we pray for your best in this transition. May they know how much that they are loved here, and may they find a warm and loving and welcoming fellowship where they move to. Your family is big. Your family is spread out. Your family is ready to embrace new members to their fellowship. And so we commit those needs to you. Father, may our hearts be ready to receive what your word speaks to us today. For the privilege of giving, we say thanks. In the incredible name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. Two other prayer requests I want to bring to your attention today, and that is I just found out at the beginning of the last service that my sister took a fall yesterday. And has either bruised or fractured a rib. So please be praying for her. Also, Bernice's daughter, Charlene Dooms, we've been praying for a bone marrow transplant, and that was supposed to possibly happen last week. And as they are making final preparations with those decisions, the donor backed out. And so they are in search of a new donor at this point. So please continue to pray for Charlene and for their family. They would appreciate that. I know so very much. I invite you to find Psalm 142, if you would, please. In just a few moments, we will be reading from Psalm 142. In our last service, Chris led us in a hymn that was just perfect for Psalm 142, a hymn that talks about that in the midst of our troubles, we can come to Christ with no disappointments. We will not be disappointed when the troubles attempt to overwhelm us. There's an old hymn that many of us grew up in church learning from the time that we were quite young. Let's see if you recognize it. Here's the way the words of that old hymn go. I would love to tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so strong and true. I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other one so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and the darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. All my life was full of sin when Jesus found me. All my heart was full of misery and woe. Jesus placed his strong and loving arms around me, and he led me in the way I ought to go. Every day, he comes to me with new assurance. More and more I understand his words of love. But I'll never know just how he came to save me till someday I see his blessed face above. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. Yesterday afternoon, late, Shelly and I were heading to dinner, and we were driving her car for a change. When you ride in my car, it's to one of two stations. It's either sports or talk radio. I get into Shelly's car, and it's at K-Love. And as we're driving, I hear a song I've never heard before. The words captured me just like that. And I mentioned to Shelly, that's the challenge I have every week when I preach, is how do we as God's children, how do we as a congregation get to the place to the where the words of the song I had never heard before are true in our lives? And you're going to hear that song at the end of the message today, all right? I don't know if it's a new song or I just kind of, it's newer than No One Ever Cared For Me Like Jesus, okay? How new it is, I'm not sure. Somebody else may know. It's so new to me that I have to look at what the title is, Eye of the Storm. Oh, okay. Some of you have heard it. I'm just catching up with y'all, all right? But it's a great, great song. And the challenge of No One Ever Cared For Me Like Jesus, the challenge of the eye in the storm, the challenge to the song that Chris led us in the 8 o'clock service in is this. How do we get to a place of spiritual health and spiritual maturity that when the troubles come, we respond automatically in dependence upon Christ so that we're not destroyed? So that we may be knocked down a bit, but we can get up because it's in the strength of Christ. How do we teach that? How do we preach that? How do we get us? So it's not just one here and one there, but it's all of us who live in that kind of reality every single day. Because here's the news for you, folks. I don't care how much trouble you've had in the past. I don't care if you've had a trouble-free life in the past. You do not have a trouble-free future ahead of you. Isn't that exactly what you came to hear today? Isn't that really good news? Yeah, there's going to be troubles and frustrations in your life. They hang out around every corner, and they catch up with us at various points in time. And all of us are going to face the frustration of death someday. Our own mortality and the mortality of those around us. This is fresh on my mind. Yesterday we had a memorial service for Marie Little Scheffler. Known her all of my life. And Marie loved Christ. She loved him, man. She could talk about Jesus at a drop of a hat to a total stranger. The daughter shared with me when they had her in ER the last time, she was preaching Jesus in the ER room, all right, at the hospital. Marie loved him. Yesterday was not a sad day, okay? There is this absence, this physical absence that we're no longer going to have here on earth, but we know where she is, and we know that we will be together again one day. We know that though she did not live a perfect life, she did not live a life that was filled with regrets. The challenges that she faced in life, she faced them in dependence upon Jesus Christ. And so even that ultimate trouble that we call death in the light of Christ in us is no trouble at all. How do we get to a point that as Christians we understand what Paul said, to live is Christ, to die is what? Gain. Does that mean, oh, well, I got to settle for dying? No, that means, well, guys, get excited. Dying's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. Don't misunderstand me. We don't have to rush the process. Do you hear me tell the story? My grandfather McLean used to travel with a black preacher quite often. They team preached at revivals, and my grandfather's friend loved to preach on heaven. He got excited preaching about heaven, and he would always in his sermon he would say, "Heaven's my home, but folks, I'm not homesick yet." And the point is, but we tend to be drawn more to this world. We're fearful because we have not seen how incredible heaven is with our own eyes. And so it sometimes makes us nervous. But could I suggest to you, were you nervous when you went to Disneyland for the very first time? No, you were excited. You couldn't wait to get there. Heaven is going to make Disneyland pale in comparison to what we're going to enjoy. Every ride in heaven is an e-ticket ride. And only those of you who are my age and older understood what I just said, because all you young, you just laugh because other people laugh. You don't even know what an e-ticket ride is, all right? But it was the best. And if you'll recall, about 6 weeks ago, one of the Psalm sermons, I really emphasized a singular point, and that is direction determines destination. And I talked about this a little bit yesterday, and it's why it's probably so fresh on my mind. I just want to throw this out at the outset. Good intentions do not determine your destination. If I were to take a show of hands, and I'm not, but if I were to take a show of hands, and I were to ask you, how many of you intend to go to heaven? Probably everybody in the room would raise their hand. If I asked that question in a public setting, probably everybody except a few people who don't believe that there's nothing after death, they would all probably raise their hand. I intend to go to heaven. Here's what you need to understand. Good intentions do not get you to heaven. Direction determines destination. Jesus said, I am the direction. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No man, no person comes to the Father but through me. He is the way to the truth, and he is the truth about the life. And you and I must get in the way. And that's what the church was called before they were called the church, all right? They referred to those new believers in the first century as they were part of the way, capital W, all right, the way. And we need to get in the way of the truth so that we have the life, and without it, our good intentions will not get us there. It is the reason that the psalmist wrote in Psalm 119, 105, the word of God is a lamp unto my feet. It is a light where? To my path, the direction in which I'm going. If you are not walking in the direction that Christ has prepared for us, your good intentions will not end you up in heaven. It's a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, that was the pre-sermon. Here's the real one. The book of Psalms is a book that deals practically with every human emotion. Whatever you're feeling at a given moment, you can find one of the 150 Psalms that will match that emotion. From sadness to joy, from sorrow to relief, you're going to find it in the book of Psalms. It's an extremely honest book. It reveals the inner thoughts, the struggles, and the needs of people, even the soon-to-be king. I should say especially the soon-to-be king, David, who wrote the vast majority of the 150 Psalms. Today we're going to look at David's cry from the cave, or as one man said, we're going to hear him from the ditch of despair. So let's read Psalm 142. As a background, not today, but if on your own or later today, if you'd like to do this, if you want to find the background to this psalm, go back and read 1 Samuel chapter 22. If you're really in a reading mood, go read from the 20th chapter to about the 24th chapter. But specifically, the events that prompted David to write this was when he was hiding in a cave, and it's described in 1 Samuel chapter 22. Let's read Psalm 142. And David wrote, I cry aloud to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. I pour out my complaint before him. Before him, I tell my troubles. When my spirit grows faint within me, it is you who know my way. Here we are back to direction again. In the path where I walk, men have hidden a snare for me. Look to my right and see. No one is concerned for me. I have no refuge. And maybe the saddest line in all the Bible, no one cares for my life. I cry to you, O Lord, and I say, you are my refuge. You are my portion in the land of the living. Listen to my cry, for I am in desperate need. Rescue me from those who pursue me, for they are too strong for me. Set me free from my prison that I may praise your name. Then the righteous will gather about me because of your goodness to me. This psalm is a prayer as well as a song. It is the substance of which David offered up to God when he was being forced by King Saul to take shelter in a cave. David had been anointed by Samuel as the next king of Israel, but it wasn't David's time to serve yet. It wasn't David's time to reign. And I got to be honest, one of the things I am most impressed about David throughout his entire life was this. He never got in a rush for God's will to be demonstrated in his life. As a young boy, he was anointed king, but David never got in a hurry to get Saul out so that he could move in. He waited patiently, even when it was very difficult to wait. David waited. Saul did not want David to become the heir to the throne, and so he tried to kill him, and that's why he was hiding in a cave. And in that cave, David said the saddest thing I've ever heard, "Nobody cares for me." Have you ever been in a dark, deep cave of discouragement or despair or depression? Have you ever been in a situation in which things looked absolutely hopeless? You looked around to others for help and found out they were completely indifferent and apathetic to your problems? Have you ever cried, "Doesn't anybody care what happens to me or my life?" We're living in a generation of hurting people who want to know that someone truly cares for them. This word care means to have thought or regards to one another, to empathize with where they are. And if we're going to be a church, and if we're going to be Christians that please God, we're going to have to become people who recognize the hurts, who care for the hurting, who stop hurting each other, and who stop hurting our own lives. In this particular chapter, we're going to notice three things. We're going to notice the condition of David at the moment that he wrote this. We're going to notice the cry of David in the midst of that condition. And last of all, we're going to notice the confidence of David in spite of his cry and his condition. The condition of David is this. Verse 1 shares with us the circumstances around this psalm. It was a prayer that David prayed while in the cave hiding from Saul. Inside a physical cave, but David was also inside a spiritual cave. In verse 3, we discover that his spirit was in a dark place. The scripture says, "My spirit was overwhelmed." Overwhelmed literally means to be shrouded, covered up. David, though, in a literal cave in the side of a hill where the light was limited, was also in a spiritual cave where light seemed to be limited. Yet, the greater darkness in his spirit was as overwhelming as the darkness of the cave. The fact that this man of God, David, had been chosen to be the future king of Israel, was overwhelmed, he reminds us of his humanness. I don't care if you're an elder of the church, a Sunday school teacher, you are the worship leader, or the pastor. There are times that the circumstances of life are humanly overwhelming and we find ourselves shrouded in darkness. It reminds us that any one of us can have periods of darkness, despair, or discouragement. Can you identify seasons of your life with David's? Overwhelmed by pressure or problems, with just life in general? How do we escape this darkness which permeates our soul at times? And how can we be prepared when that next season of darkness may come our way so that we don't end up destroyed, but we can respond in the way that David did? It long been noticed in European countries that people develop depression during the long, dark days of winter. It was back in the early 1980s when a handful of experts at the National Institute of Mental Health had an idea. They said, if people get depressed when the days get darker, why not just give them more light? So they tested their theory, and one of the men who volunteered for the test was Herb Kern. He was a 63-year-old research engineer who fell into a deep depression every autumn. They asked Kern to sit in front of a large box fitted with fluorescent lights for 3 hours before dawn and 3 hours after sunset every day. This was where the tanning booth originated. That I'm just kidding about. I have no idea if that was true or not. 3 days later, Kern was smiling again. In the 15 years when this research was done, further studies had shown the effectiveness of light therapy for patients with winter depression. And any time that scientists or medical professionals can figure something out like this, they have to give it a name. And so they call the name of this situation SAD. S-A-D. And that stands for Seasonal Affective Disorders. So are any of you sad? Do you have seasonal affective disorder due to a lack of light? Let me transfer this physical study into a spiritual application. How can you and I overcome being overwhelmed with spiritual darkness? Get in the light. Perfect. Whoever said that, you're absolutely correct. Stay in the light. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Psalm 119, 105 once again says, the word is a lamp unto my feet. It is a light unto my path. Instead of 3 hours of fluorescent lighting, how about 30 minutes to begin the day and to end the day in the light of God's word for your life? It will give you direction, which is essential for destination. Not only was his spirit in darkness, but his steps were also in danger. David had been nothing but loyal to Saul. He had done nothing to deserve the jealous rage that Saul felt for him. David's steps are in danger because Saul is intent on killing him. Sometimes when you have done nothing wrong to another person, their intent is still to hurt you. And sometimes our steps are in danger. David also, in verse 4, we discover his soul seemed deserted. In all the Bible, there are few words that are sadder than, I looked on my right, and there was no man who knew me. There was no one who cared for my soul. Mother Teresa of Calcutta once said, loneliness and the feeling of being uncared for and unwanted are the greatest poverties in the world. There's more empty feeling in the human heart than loneliness to believe that no one cares. Most of us have gone through times of loneliness. We probably already had some times when we wondered if anybody cared for us. Perhaps you need to be reminded that you are loved and that you are cared for. Perhaps you need to tell or show somebody else that you care for them, but more importantly, that God cares for them. We can go into a big city at night and see all the lights and the activity and everything seems to be so alive, but I promise you, somewhere in that city, someone sits in darkness. They feel deserted. They feel as if no one cares. The world we live in needs to know God cares. Sarah Tisdale, some of you readers or poets might recognize the name. She was an American poet, won numerous awards for her writing, including the Columbia University Poetry Society Award, the Pulitzer Prize for Poetry, and the Poetry Prize from the American Poetry Society. Listen to a four-line poem that she wrote. Somewhere in the early 1930s. She said, my soul is a dark plowed field in a really cold rain. My soul is a broken field plowed by pain. And in 1933, Sarah Tisdale died of an overdose of sleeping pills. The loneliness was too much. A few years ago, the press carried a very heart-rending story of a young dad who shot himself in a tavern telephone booth. James Lee had called a Chicago newspaper and told a reporter that he had sent the paper a manila envelope outlining his personal story. The reporter frantically tried to trace the call, but was too late. When the police arrived, the young man was slumped in the booth with a bullet through his head. In his pockets, they found a child's crayon drawing, folded and worn. On it was written these words, please leave in my coat pocket, I want to have it buried with me. The drawing was signed in childish print by his daughter. Her name was Shirley Lee. She had perished in a fire 5 months before. Lee was so grief-stricken over the death of his daughter, he asked total strangers to attend her memorial service so she would have a nice crowd. He said there was no family to attend. Her mother had been dead since she was two. Speaking to the reporter before his death, this heartbroken father said that all he had in life was gone and he felt so alone. He gave his modest estate to the church where Shirley had attended as a young girl and said, maybe in 20 years, someone will see a plaque of the donation that was made and wonder who Shirley Ellen Lee was and say, someone must have loved her very, very much. The grieving father could not stand the loneliness of the loss, and he took his own life. He felt it better to be dead than to live in an impersonal world. And I wonder, how many James Lees are there in the world? They don't wear signs saying, I'm lonely, will you help me? We just cannot be that honest. I drove the intersection of Knees and Blackstone yesterday, coming back from Oakhurst, Coarse Gold. And there was a bearded man on a corner holding a sign said, I won't lie to you, I need a beer. I wished I had a sign. I could have been on his back and said, sorry, I don't buy beer, okay? Buy you a meal, but I don't buy beer. But nobody is courageous enough to hold up a sign and say, I'm lonely. So what do we do when those moments overwhelm us? I think David has some direction for us. From within that cave of darkness, we hear the cry of David, the cry of a man in need. He cries to the one who can meet the needs of his heart. And it wasn't his own earthly father, and it wasn't his own brothers, and it wasn't his best friend. He cried out to God. Verse 2, his cry of dissatisfaction. I poured out my complaint before him. I showed before him my trouble. I was just honest before God. You got any complaints? Do you feel alone or sad? Then pour them out to God. God has a complaint department that'll listen to everything you have to say. Too often we turn our pity into a party and we bathe ourselves in it rather than pouring our heart out before the Lord. He also gives us a cry of declaration in verse 5. David prays what he knows and not what he feels. Let me say that one more time. David prays what he knows, not what he feels. Our feelings are not always the truth. Our feelings will not always be right. David, after he pours out his dissatisfaction, he prays what he knows to be true. Even though he feels like nobody cares, in spite of that, he prays to a Lord that he knows cares. He declares and proclaims, God, you are my refuge. David is in a cave trying to conceal himself from Saul, yet David knows that ultimately his refuge is in the Lord, and he reveals himself, all of himself, to God himself. His cry is also for deliverance. I cried out, verse 6. I cried out means to prick the ears. I bring my soul out of prison. God can deliver us. He has the power to do that. He delivers us from our sins and through our sorrows and even in our solitude. Cry out to him. Pour out your heart. Trust that he will deliver you. I want to pause just for a moment to examine the condition of all of our souls without Christ. And I want you to listen to these seven words. And there's more than seven that describe it, but I'm just going to highlight seven. And the reason I want to do this is because most of you have forgotten. Most of us have forgotten who we were before Christ came to live within us. And the bigger sadness for me is not only have we forgotten what we were before Christ, is I think we have forgotten who our friends and our relatives and our co-workers are who have not yet found Christ. And when we don't remember this, we are inclined to close ourselves off in a bubble and we just say, you know what, I'm going to let other folks find it all on their own. And God calls you and I in the Scriptures to be His ambassadors, His declarers of God's good will and love to others. Here's the condition of all of us before Christ and our friends and relatives who still have not found Him yet. In Luke chapter 19 and 2 Corinthians chapter 4, the Bible says all of us were lost. You know one of the saddest things that I face when I drive down a highway? It's when I come across one of those digital boards and it says Amber Alert. because I know there is a child that is lost, a child that probably has been stolen, and they're lost. Every one of us before Christ had been stolen by Satan, and we're lost. And God wants us to get found. John chapter 3, 1 Corinthians 11 describes all of us apart from Christ as condemned. We've been sentenced. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12 says we are a people without hope when we are without Christ. Yesterday, there was a sanctuary filled with hope as we celebrated Marie Scheffler's life. It was not without hope. I told them yesterday, if I did not believe in Jesus Christ, His finished work and His resurrection, I would rather be playing golf. I'd rather be watching a football game. I would rather somebody take a hammer and pound my fingers than I had to be at a funeral preaching a sermon when there is no hope. But we are not without hope when we know Christ. The Bible also describes us in John 3 and 2 Peter 3 as we are perishing. Our good intentions will not provide us eternal life. We must be going in the direction of the way, otherwise we will perish. The Bible describes us in John 3:36 and Romans 1:18 as we are under God's wrath. 2 Corinthians 4 and Ephesians 4, it tells us that we are spiritually blind. We cannot see. And Ephesians 2 and Colossians 2 tell us we are spiritually dead without Christ. In the light of these truths, where is our concern for the world? Do we really care for them? Do we care about them going into eternity without God? I've got it. I don't need to worry about anybody else. Let me wrap this up. We see in Psalm 142 in the last verse, the confidence of David. Verse 7 is a great statement of faith from a man who is in a low estate. It says, though his feelings may not be there, he kept faith in God and exercised his faith in God. He said, bring my soul out of prison. Set me out of prison, and the righteous will gather about me because of your goodness. Bring me out of prison for what purpose? So that I can praise you. David has confidence that he will be surrounded by the people of God. Not only will he shout praise to God, but he'll be surrounded by the people of God. The righteous will come join me. All alone, David shows a remarkable faith in God in spite of his circumstances. He's alone at the moment, but he believes that when God delivers him, he'll stand with a host of others and worship God together. And David has confidence that he will be shown the promises of God. It says, you will deal bountifully, generously with me. Let me wrap this up. I told you I wanted to share a song with you. Maybe it's new to some of you. Obviously, some of you knew it as soon as I mentioned the title. They're going to lower the screen and prepare to show it. Okay? While that's happening, I want to just read the first two verses of this song and the chorus. In the eye of the storm, you, talking about God, remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When the solid ground is falling out from underneath my feet, between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. When I realize I've been sold out by my friends and my family, I can feel the rain reminding me. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When my hopes and dreams are far from me and I'm running out of faith, I see the future. I picture slowly fade away. And when the tears of pain and heartache are falling down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. Let's watch this. When it gets maybe to the second time to the chorus, if you want to join in, please feel free to join right in. But listen particularly to the words and the message of the verses. They are powerful. As I shared with you last week, Lucy got the message that she had stage 4 cancer. Didn't hear about it in stage 1, stage 2, or stage 3. When she went to the doctor, was already at stage 4. She said, Doc, you don't need to do anything for me. I know where I'm going. Hospice has been called. Arrangements have been made. Lucy's still doing good. If you know her, if you've been to her mobile home before, give her a call, go see her. My desire is that we as a church family, not just one or two of us, but all of us get to a place that when we're in the cave, when we're in the eye of the storm, when the war is raging, we know where to go, to whom to go, and where the source of our strength is, and that is to Jesus Christ. Let's close in prayer. Father, if there's someone here who thought they were going to heaven because of good intentions, I trust they've heard enough today to discover they need direction, and they realize that you are the way to the truth. And I trust at this very moment, the quietness of their heart, they would say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Come live within my heart. I want your life to make a difference in mine so that my life can make a difference for others. Thank you for hearing that prayer. Father, for those who are here and they're crying out like David from a cave because they felt alone and isolated, may today they do what David did. They'll move beyond their feelings and they will trust and abide in the truth. And they will pray to you, giving you thanks in advance for the deliverance, the freedom, the peace, the contentment that you provide. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Happy Thanksgiving. Hope to see you next week.